On the 23rd of June, the people of Britain will be called upon to vote on the question as to whether we remain or leave the European Union. And the interesting thing is that just about 10 days before we are called upon to cast our vote, that public opinion in this country is more confused and divided, if that's possible, than at the beginning. Now, this is incredible, given the fact that we've had months, in effect, of campaigning on both sides. We are presented with a mass of arguments, of facts, of figures, or alleged facts and alleged figures, on both sides, arguing furiously the case for staying or leaving. And yet, in spite of this surfeit of information, or should I say misinformation in the main, people are confused. Not only confused, I would argue that most people actually are confused and turned off by the whole procedure. This campaign, so-called, has created much more heat than light, as they say. People are not enlightened. People don't to this day say, well, we don't have enough facts. Well, of course, you've been presented with plenty of facts to suit all tastes. And the tone of this discussion, the sharpness, that's interesting, is becoming ever sharper. It degenerates into a trading of insults between whom? That's the point. This, my friends, is very clearly a row between two rival wings of the British ruling class. I'll be more specific. It is a very serious row. It's a serious split. It's an abysm has opened up between two rival layers of the Conservative Party. And by the way, this is perhaps the most important consequence of this whole lamentable affair. No matter what the result is on the 23rd of June, you can bet your bottom dollar that it will lead to a sharpening of divisions in the ranks of the Tory Party and a split in the Tory Party, I would argue, at a certain stage. It is quite interesting to note that in the Remain camp, and by the way, what a rogues gallery we have, just look at them. Cameron, Osborne, Tony Blair, yes, reminds me a bit of the film The Night of the Living Dead, all these former so-called Labour leaders, Neil Kinnock, Gordon Brown, all the rest of these wretched right-wing Tories in disguise, because that's what they are and always were, they've all been dragged out in support of the Remain camp. Now, what argument do they put forward? Well, of course, they try to instill fear into people, and it is quite probable, by the way, that the warnings that they give about the economic dangers of breaking from Europe are well-founded. I don't doubt it for a moment that there will be a serious crisis, and therefore that argument, of course, is a substantial one. But what's noticeable from my point of view is that not one of them tries to put forward a positive case. You know, the Brexit crowd argue, well, this is a project fear, this is trying to put the fear of God into us, which of course it is. Yes, but you see, none of them, some of them moan, you know, particularly the wretched Labour right wing, Tories in disguise, every man jack of them. Oh, we're not putting forward a sufficiently positive case. And they blame Jeremy Corbyn. Poor Jeremy Corbyn is blamed for this. I don't know. One of these days they blame him for the weather, you know. We're having a lot of rain in Britain. Undoubtedly that must be the fault of Jeremy Corbyn. Poor chap, he can't do anything right. If he went against the European Union, which he always has done in the past for many years, then of course they'd blame him for that. And now, because he's come out and campaigning for Remain, although in terms which they don't share, he's blamed for that. He's not strong enough, you see. I mean, good heavens above, these gangsters of the Labour right wing are determined to finish with Jeremy Corbyn no matter what the man does. In fairness to Jeremy, no matter what you think about the Remain campaign, at least he's refused to share a platform with Osborne and Cameron and the other gangsters, which scoundrels like Sadiq Khan, the so-called left, he was sold to us as a left, some left mayor we got in London now, this Tory scoundrel, this Tory in disguise, another one of the Blairite gang. Oh yes, they fall over themselves to cringe and collaborate with Osborne and with Cameron and the Tories. At least Jeremy Corbyn doesn't do that. And very often Corbyn's arguments also have got some basis, where he says, well, look, if Brexit wins, they're going to make a bonfire of regulations. You better believe it. And he says quite, he asks a coherent and a fair question, which regulations are you going to start with? Perhaps it's the working week directive, or perhaps it's health and safety. Very sound arguments, by the way. At least Jeremy would have give him his due. He has adopted a fairly reasonable position, unlike the other Labour, so-called Labour right-wingers, who immediately jump into bed with the Conservatives. By the way, I warn you now that you can see here the outlines of a future realignment of British politics, of a split in the Conservative Party between the ultra-right wing, which is the Brexit crowd, the most reactionary wing, and the so-called left-wing Tories of the Cameron ilk. They have much more in common with Labour's right wing, and Labour's right wing have got much more common with them than with anybody else. And this is perhaps a warning for the future. But none of these guys, despite the fact that they moan and they groan, why aren't we putting forward a positive case for Europe? Well, I ask myself, what kind of a positive case can you make out for the European Union? This wonderful union of the people driving towards ever greater harmony and a unification of the people and so on. Well, not so. The European Union, let's be clear about it, is a capitalist club which is owned and controlled by a handful of big capitalist monopolies. It's not an accident that the City of London in the main and the big capitalist corporations in Britain are in favour of remaining, because that's their club. They're members of this privileged club, which has nothing to do with the working class or the working people or the unity of Europe, if it comes to that. No, the real reactionary nature of this outfit was sharply revealed over the Greek crisis, the scandalous conduct of Frau Merkel and Schäuble and the other gang, who really control the European Union. Look at the way that they crushed the Syriza government in Greece. They mercilessly crushed them and denied the Greek people even their elementary democratic rights. All these arguments are perfectly correct. It's an imperialist club, a reactionary gang, without any progressive content whatsoever. And by the way, the argument in favour of European Union and European integration and so on, it's just nonsense. That has reached its limits a long time ago, and in fact it's gone into reverse. That's why it's nonsense on the part of the Brexit crowd to put forward this scarecrow. Oh, look, they're going to form a European state. Nonsense. They're going to form a European army. Some ex-generals just said that. Well, no such thing. No such luck, my friends. No. Anyone with brains, anyone with half a brain or with eyes to see, can see what's happening. Far from leading to greater and greater union, on the contrary, there's greater and greater disunion, for goodness sake. The euro is in a mess. It's in a total crisis. The Greek crisis has not been resolved, by the way, not in the slightest degree. The Schengen agreement is just, it's in ruins. Where's the Schengen agreement when the Danes and the Swedes and the Austrians and others are erecting barriers, not to speak of the external barriers? Frau Merkel was very friendly and very welcoming to the refugees. No doubt big business in Germany could do with some cheap labour, it's true. That's why the big monopolies are in favour of this. Yes, but this humanitarian image, this smiling mask of humanitarianism, didn't last very long, did it? Now we got razor wire fences being erected all around the perimeter of fortress Europe to keep out this mass of unfortunate victims of war in the Middle East. So humanitarian and democratic and internationalist it is not. And therefore, you cannot argue from a socialist perspective in any sense, you can't defend the European Union. And from that point of view, the Remain crowd are a reactionary gang of big business stooges and agents and parasites, as you'd expect. That is to say, the so-called progressive Tories of Cameron and Osborne, progressive, of course, they are not. and the right-wing Labour gang, who are Tories in disguise, who have hijacked the Labour Party and, of course, are absolutely at one, completely unified with the Conservatives. They'll end up in the same party. I will bet money on it. Yes, but what about the other crowd, you see? What about the Brexit crowd? And here, of course, I agree entirely with Jeremy Corbyn, what he said. The Brexit gang, if it's possible, are even worse than the other crowd. Just look at them. Boris Johnson, Boris the Barbarian, as he's known in the trade, this wretched UKIP, Nigel Farage, that gangster, that racist gangster. Gove and the others. These are the ultra-right wing of the Tories and the ruling class in Britain. Now, anyone that can see, can see that, I'm very sorry for them. And the question is this. Why does the working class have to take sides in a conflict and a split in the ranks of the British ruling class? I ask you. Are we obliged? Is there something written in the laws of history or Marxist theory that obliges us to take sides in a conflict within the ruling class? Let me remind you of something which some so-called Marxists have forgotten. In the 19th century, when Karl Marx was confronted with a similar situation, that's to say, a sharp conflict within the British capitalist class between the supporters of protectionism and free trade, so what did Marx say? Did he say, oh no, we must support free trade because it's more progressive or something of that sort? On the contrary, Marx's position and our position is to defend at all times the principle of complete class independence of the working class from all the factions of the bourgeoisie, whether they're the so-called liberal progressive faction or whether they're the conservative reactionary faction. And yet you have what, in my opinion, is an absolute scandal, I repeat that, my friends, an absolute scandal of so-called left groups and so-called Marxist groups in Britain, I'll name them, the Socialist Party and the SWP and others of their ilk, which are lining up with Brexit. Oh yes, they put forward all kinds of smart aleck arguments. Oh no, we're really in favour of a socialist Brexit, you see, a socialist party. Yes, but you see, my friends, life is not like that. We're not dealing here with a socialist Brexit. We're dealing with a capitalist Brexit. That's what we're dealing with. And let's be clear about this. If the Brexit gang succeed in the vote on the 23rd of June, will that be a victory for socialism? You think that the people will vote on that basis? What is the main plank of the argument of Mr. Gove and the other shower? It's anti-immigration. Oh yes, there is no, it's not only their main plank, it's their only plank, which they're banging on day in and day out. They're appealing not to the most advanced layers of the working class, not to the most advanced classes, but the most backward, the most retrograde, the most conservative, yes, the most reactionary elements in the working class. Oh yes, you haven't got a house because of the immigrants. You haven't got a job because of the immigrants, which is a complete lie, of course. But that's the line of the Brexit crowd. If you support us, you'll have more pensions and more wages and more rights and more democracy. Oh yes, they're all for the working class, all for the NHS, all for the welfare state, which is being threatened, and so on. Really, you know, it isn't often that I have occasion to praise John Major, you know, the former Conservative Prime Minister, but he did, I don't know whether he had too much to drink, he said something serious the other day, for a change. He said the following, £350 million a week, which is a lie, by the way, what this, it is a lie, £350 million, they're running around Britain with posters saying that if this money going into the European Union, if we had control of this, the we, my friend, is not you and me, it's not the British working class, the we is precisely these gangsters, the Goves and the Johnsons. Yes, those are the people that would have control of this money. It wouldn't be £350 million, by the way, because they don't include the other subsidies which they and paybacks which they get off the European Union. We won't enter into that. I'm not interested in that kind of argy-bargy, just to say this, John Major said it. And for once he said something seriously. Serious. He said the following, yes, these people want to give this money to the National Health. He said, don't make me laugh. Michael Gove wanted to privatise the NHS. Oh yes, that's Michael Gove for you. That's the leader, that's the official leader of the Brexit camp. And Boris Johnson wanted to charge people for the NHS. So don't give me this nonsense. Oh, if we had £350 million we'd pay to the NHS. Nonsense. Nonsense. If Britain leaves under these conditions, which will not be the nice picture painted by some so-called left-wingers, if the Brexit will be a react, it will mean, of course, the fall of Cameron. Nobody will lose any tears about that. I certainly will not. But the question is not that, my friend. If Cameron goes, the question is concrete one. Who will take his place? And who will take his place? It will be the right wing, the extreme ultra-right wing, the chauvinist, anti-immigrant, quasi-racist elements of the free marketeers, of course. Thatcherites, that's what they are. They will take control. And you think they will give extra money to the National Health? You must be living in a different Britain to me. No. It'll mean, first of all, it will mean an economic crisis. And of course, the bill will be handed over to the working class. And all those so-called lefts that are supporting Brexit will be rubbing their socialist backsides. And it'll be a bit too late, as far as that is concerned. So we're left with a slight dilemma here. Who do we support? Do we support the European Union or do we support Brexit? It's a bit like saying, well, would you prefer cholera or AIDS? You know, which do you prefer? Well, I wouldn't like either of them, as a matter of fact. This split, my friends, is a conflict. It's a split between sharks and crocodiles. And the working class cannot take sides in this. I'm very sorry. It's no good. We always hear this damned argument. Every time when a war breaks out, oh yeah, must be practical. What are we supposed to do? As if we're supposed to do anything in this situation. Yes, we should do something. We should expose both sides with equal vehemence. We should expose the sharks and the crocodiles. Expose both the Blairite and Osborne and Cameron faction, and the other gang, the racists, that's what they are, racist and anti-immigrant and free marketeer Thatcherite gang. Are you really suggesting to me that Marxists have got a bounden duty to take sides in this conflict? I don't accept it. What we have to do, to quote Lenin in 1917, is patiently explain. That's what people want, by the way. People are confused by this. Most people don't know what to do on the 23rd. We should patiently tell the truth. Tell the truth. On the one hand, the European capitalist common market, there's no future for Britain in that, except a further cuts and further crises. That's perfectly true. You see, the interesting thing is, if you read what both sides say about each other, then you'll get somewhere near to the truth. Because they're both liars. Both gangs are scoundrels. Both are enemies, equally enemies of the working class. No question about this whatsoever. We should expose both of them and explain the position. Inside the European Union, there's no future for Britain and for the working class. That's perfectly, perfectly true. We agree with the Brexit crowd on that. But outside, on a capitalist basis, and that's what's on offer. Not some kind of socialist paradise in mid-Atlantic, which is being hinted at by some, is a Thatcherite Britain. That's what's being proposed. And there will be a serious crisis if Britain leaves. Incidentally, a serious crisis not just for Britain, but for Europe. And it could have that's what they're frightened of. It will have a knock-on effect for the entire capitalist world economy. No question about it. And therefore, comrades and friends, we must take an independent class position. I'm very sorry for those who want to argue one side or the other. We're not entering into that nonsense. And you shouldn't enter into it either if you claim to represent Marxism and socialism and the cause of the working class. The interest of the working class is to understand that the nature of our problem is not the European Union, it's not the Euro, it's not Angela Merkel alone. Certainly it's not immigrants that are taking away our jobs and the NHS and so on and so forth. The problem is capitalism, my friends. The problem is the crisis of capitalism. Europe is in crisis, a terrible crisis, which will not be solved on a capitalist basis. But if Britain leaves, will that solve us? Answer the question. In what way, in what shape, sense or form will breaking away from the European Union on a capitalist basis solve the problems of the working class? It will not. That's a lie. You say that, my friend, you're deceiving yourself and you're deceiving the working class and you're deceiving the British people. And this is unforgivable from a Marxist point of view. No. Our position is to remain firm against the pressures from both sides and put forward the only possible argument, the only possible solution for the British working class and the British is to fight for socialism, fight to overthrow the rule of the banks and the monopolies, not just in Britain, but also in Europe. We should link hands with our comrades and brothers and sisters in the European working class, which is moving. Look at Spain, look at Greece, look at Portugal, look wherever you like. You see, a movement of the working class, that is our future, that is our internationalism, that's our class. And our perspective, of course, in the longer term is to fight, first of all, fight for socialism in Britain. And the prior condition for that is to maintain absolute independence from any split or faction of the capitalist class. Fight for socialism in Britain as part of a larger fight for the socialist transformation of the whole continent of Europe, and Europe, the European working class, that is to say, is moving in that direction, to fight for socialism in Britain, and yes, to fight for a socialist Europe, for the socialist United States of Europe.